Welcome everybody to our final day of the Data Cities weekend, which is the Community Day. So my name is Lieke Ploeger and I'm directing the community program of the Disruption Network Lab, and I'm running that together with my colleague here. So maybe you can.
Hi, I'm Nada Bakr, and yes, together with Lieke, we run the community for the second year today of the Disruption Network Lab.
And of course, this conference was also curated by Tatiana Bazzichelli. So many thanks also to her. So she's the artistic director of the Disruption Network Lab. And yeah, today we're gonna try out this first time, this final workshops day, so following on the main conference, because we want to connect today the topic of the Data Cities Conference with the work of communities, activists, and initiatives that are here in Berlin, but also abroad. So in this way, we're extending our usual meetup program, which Nada will talk a bit about later. And we want to focus on sharing skills, tools, and strategies to work with data and technology in creative ways so we can shape the kind of city that we want to live in the future. So the program of today, we will start first with an artist talk by Simon Weckert, especially focused on his Google Maps Hacks project, but also around his methodology in general. And then we continue with a series of afternoon workshops. So there will be four different workshops happening. The first one is not happening in this space, but in a space nearby. And this will be Smash Your Filter Bubble with the community of the Tracking Exposed project. So we're going to work on exposing the algorithm behind YouTube. The other workshop here happening in the space is on visualizing control and critical mapping, which is with River Honer, who was also a speaker on Friday here at the Data Cities Conference. Then there will be a workshop happening upstairs with Felipe Fonseca about reuse, recycle, and repair, hacking waste management for the smart city. And finally, the fourth workshop will be with Elisabeth Calderon-Luning, and it will focus on working out a data manifesto for a smart city. And then at the end of the day, so this will be the whole afternoon, we will come back together with all of us, and we will hear what's been happening in the workshops and sharing our experiences and outcomes. Then, just to remind you briefly of the safety rules around this event, so we're very happy to be back here at Studio One and to do the event here together. But of course, we have to be careful to keep the distance, wear the masks when we're walking around. You can disinfect your hands, there are some hand sanitizers everywhere. And also, we would like to ask you that when there is a break, that you leave this room. It's actually nice weather again today, so we can also be outside so that we can air the room and have a fresh room when we come back. And you got a little token when coming in with a seat number. So when the day is over, please make sure to also return this token again at the cash desk. And then before we actually get started, of course, also thanks to our funders and cooperation partners. So our program this year is supported by the Senat Department for Culture and Europe here in Berlin, the Bundeszentrale für politische Bildung, the Riva and David Logan Foundation, and the Checkpoint Charlie Foundation. And we're also supported by a grant from the Foundation Open Society Institute in cooperation with the OSIFA of the Open Society Foundations. And this work is part of the Reimagine Europe project, which falls under the Creative Europe program of the European Union. And especially for the community program, we also would like to thank the Guerrilla Foundation for their support. And then we have been working for this event specifically in cooperation with the Human Rights Film Festival for the screening we did on Thursday of the I Human film. And we have been collaborating with Transparency International, the Common Action Forum, and the Weizenbaum Institute. And also we want to thank the partner venues where we have also been doing some of our meetups, so Akut Magnoi, State Studio, and Supermarkt Berlin, and of course the Kunstraum Kreuzberg Bethania, where we are today. And the media partners are Taz, Ex-Berliner and Furtherfield, and of course also a very big thanks to Boiling Head Media, who's helping out for all the live streaming that we're doing of the event. And also a welcome to the people that are joining us on the live stream. Then handing over to Nada to speak a bit about our meetup program, which is the other part of the community program.
Thanks, Lieke. And thank you for joining this second community activation program that we do for the community program running around the year, and also for some of you, the presence throughout the year in the community meetups and engagements we have done. At the beginning of this year, we had to close our program in March on the ground after our first meetup at ECUD, and we immediately kind of reviewed the program and our practices in community building, looking into how and what we could transfer to do online, ongoing, to keep the connection with our community. And from the beginning of this crisis, we have been anticipating the topics that we, the community and the Disruption Network Lab has been working on, has become very more relevant than ever and excessively amplified with the crisis. Also, once the crisis erupted into a global pandemic, we have seen fragility of systems that built on capitalist profit and not based on public needs of health or common care. So that's why, without getting like the introduction further, I would first like to thank and mention the groups and initiatives who worked with us this year, online and on the ground. So we have worked together with Berlin versus Amazon, Coty & Co, Kunstblock, Christopher Trout-Witter, the Guerrilla Architect, the Syndicat Collective, that unfortunately have already lost their space, the Stop Eviction Alliances in Berlin, and the Subvertising Collective, Steel Disposter and Special Patrol Group. And for the conference of data series, we have organized, fortunately, one meetup on the ground in Akkud with Amber McIntyre of Tactical Tech on the dealing with personal data for organizers, who organize event demonstration and workshops, and how to explore issues surrounding personal data, privacy, and working with data of your community in organizing events. After the conference, we still have one more meetup to go with Adam Harvey behind facial recognition databases. So Adam Harvey is an artist and researcher, and on that evening at State Studio on the 7th of October, he will be talking about the project he has been working with, like Megapixel, to explore facial recognition databases made in cities across different places and understand more about where this data is organized and how it's used. You can still register online. There's a couple of free spots. So we're about to run out of spots. So if you really want to attend, please register.
I think we
look forward to continue with this year and the next year building community in whatever way we will do our events. Let's see how the events unfold in the upcoming months. Despite the fact that being here in the room, even with all the limitation, is definitely an irreplaceable experience for us. So thank you so much, and we look forward to share more of the stage during the whole day. And now I leave the floor to Lika and Simon for the talk. So
I would like to welcome Simon on the stage.
Okay. And thank you.
I'll give a short.
I leave it to you.
So I will introduce briefly Simon Weckert, who we're very excited to have with us today for the opening artist talk, which we hope can serve as inspiration for the day of workshops that we're about to do. So Simon Weckert is an artist based here in Berlin, and he likes to share knowledge on a wide range of fields, from generative design to physical computing. And he focuses in his work on the digital world, including everything relating to code and electronics, but also under the reflection of current social aspects. So in his work, he seeks to assess the value of technology, not in terms of actual utility, but from the perspective of future generations. And he wants to raise awareness of the privileged state in which people live within the Western civilization, and also remind them of the obligations that are attached to this privilege. So the work he will also speak about, Google Maps hacks, was actually quite a lot in the news earlier this year. And also he won the Award of Distinction at the Ars Electronica for the Interactive Art category. And today we will hear more about the methodology behind his projects and how he works to impact the physical space and creating, as he calls it, some playful mischief. So very much looking forward to that. Over to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me, first of all. Thank you for the introduction. And also, basically also for me, it's quite an honor, first of all, to give you today a kind of presentation about the Google Maps hacks. But I think my aim today is also to give you, let's say, a glimpse of what digital maps means to us and how they changed the way how we read maps and how they also basically create world models that we are relying to. Yeah, the title of the presentation is "The Map is Not a Territory, but Just Another Version of Reality." Actually, unfortunately, you already said a lot about my artworks or basically the motivation behind it. But again, so I'm Simon Reckert. I'm a Berlin-based artist. I studied at the University of Art, and there I was much more interested in to work with algorithms and technology and basically questioning these tools which I'm using there, and of course also in a way questioning how they influence and how they basically also shape our society. Like, for example, McLuhan said, like, at first we shape our tools and then they shape us, and at some point it's for me like a leading sentence, I would say. So this is just a screenshot of my website. As you can see, I'm, you know, basically trying to work in different fields with different methods, with different technologies, with different stories, and basically I'm really trying to not to innovate, to limit myself, and really try to be open and also welcome to for people when they ask, like, are you interested in a cooperation for this or this project, just to let you know. So again, I would like to talk about maps, and I think when we think about maps, then we always have to think about how maps have been used, especially back in the days, as an instrument of power and as an instrument of control and an instrument to argue, to shape and to define areas, to basically take a liner and a pen and then, like we see it here on this map, to say, okay, this is my part, this is your part, or also when we're talking about colonization, how people have been divided by those maps and have been used as an argument to split them. And so it means that maps are like such a powerful, such a strong, let's say, tool and instrument to represent a specific worldview, and of course also to make politics with it. And so, as we know it, maps can be, for example, can draw borders, for example, but they can also use another specific, tool or graphic symbols like a circle for a city, or let's say like a, I don't know, let's say black line for a street, or something like for representation for a river, right? And these kind of graphical sets, they're also representing some kind of generalization. So when we see a map, then we always have to think about, this is really just a generalized point of view. This is not the real world, it's really just representation, but there can be so many other different point of views about this area, what we're seeing there. So that's always, I think, what we should not forget. And when we see a map, that can be never seen as the real world, it's really just representation of the real world. And, think about, like, I guess, Mercator projection, where we always give them some kind of, it's like a super central, Europe central map. I think most of the people in Germany learn it in the school, that they see this kind of projection, and therefore they can also give them, like, Europe a much more, let's say, importantness in this map, because Europe is in that sense much more a place in the center. But there are so many different, let's say, versions and variations how you can present the world map. So I think that we should always have this in mind. And how maps can be used for some kind of political statements or some kind of political, let's say, motivations can be seen here in this project, which I did last year. That's so-called Google Maps Borders. So I was writing a kind of algorithm to scan Google Maps on their, let's say, borders of their countries. And you have to know that there are different Google Maps, let's say, versions. So basically there is like a Google Maps Ukraine, there's a Google Maps France, there's a Google Maps Russia, there's a Google Maps India and US and so on. And I was interested in if Google is showing us the same informations when we're gonna use the different Google Maps versions. And what I found was that it's not like this. So what you can see, for example, on the top is the, on the left side, you see Google Maps India, and on the right side, you see Google Maps China, and especially for the Kashmir region there, you can definitely see that the borders are different. So of course we know that's like an old conflict between the two countries, and it's still in a way not somehow, let's say, 100% clear how they're going to deal with it, and it's always like this kind of forward-backward process. But I think what's important here is to see that Google is kind of, you know, standing behind the local opinion of this country, and I think I would say that they are also in a way trying to not lose the local market of online map services in this country there when they are not in the sense representing the local opinion. And here I would say they are definitely making politics, and they are not dealing in a neutral way with their maps how it should be. So same thing, for example, is here on the bottom, like when you see Google Maps Russia and Google Maps Ukraine, and we all remember the annexation of the Krim Island, or the Krim, between Russia and Ukraine. And on the left side, you see that the border between Ukraine and the Krim Island is like a line, and it's definitely saying, okay, this island belongs to Russia. But when you see it on the Ukraine side, then suddenly it's like a stroke line, and the state is somehow unclear. So this definitely, for me, represents some worldviews, and it creates actually some kind of imbalance between what kind of information we are getting with regards to where we're coming from, and then it's quite hard for us, to come to a common sense when we are getting different arguments, when we are getting different informations by those tools. So yeah, what maps are for us is, in general, I think like when you have a look, let's say a look at the underground map here, then there's interesting way how we see these maps in it always. So when I'm standing in front of this map, then there's a red dot, and the red dot is showing me you are here. So basically, I'm pointing to this map and saying I'm there, but in the same time, I'm pointing basically through this map on to myself that I'm here. So this basically, I'm pointing on myself in the map where I am. But the problem is with maps in general that we always don't know where we are exactly when we don't know where the map is located in our physical space, and therefore we need, for example, GPS orientation systems or compass tools to locate this map in the world we are living. And I would say that, or maybe that's the aim of every cartographer or, let's say, person who are creating maps, is that they are trying to make the map, let's say, detailed as possible, and with every edge, with every corner, so to have really like a, let's say, one-to-one representation of the real world. This comes quite close to the idea, for example, Umberto Eco, he was writing about it, that he had the idea of a map which comes in dimension one by one, meaning that this map is exactly the same, size like the Earth or like the globe is. And he was imagining a map which is like a transparent, invisible, or not invisible, more like a layer onto the surface, which you can unroll, and then basically you can work on it. Of course, this kind of map, let's say, if you think about to print it, it's not possible because basically it's like super unpractical. But I would say that today's online maps, like Google's maps, they are, I would say, pretty good representer of this idea. And we can make them visible with our smartphones. So the smartphone, so to say, is more like a window. It's more like a tool to make this kind of transparent hidden layer of a virtual or invisible map visible. So there we're gonna come to the topic basically where everything started and I was really interested in, is how these digital tools, how Google Maps and how this this new way to see maps have shaped the way how we work in the city, how we use this tool to interact with other actors in the city, or how we also how it's also basically shaping the way how we're gonna travel, for example. So Google Maps started in, I think, 2005, followed by Street View. And these maps have, I would say, fundamentally changed our understanding how we read maps, right? I guess when you ask somebody, think about a map, I would say that for most of the people, what pops up in their mind is more like a virtual map, like the ones which is defined by Google. So we could say that aesthetically wise, they're also defining in a way like how maps look like these days. And of course, they have like little in common with analog printed maps, so they are like scrollable, zoomable, and also searchable. And so I would say that since 2005, with the advance of it, a lot of, let's say, things change how we understand maps and how we read them. I mean, of course, it's quite obvious that one of the benefits of digital maps is that they can implement data there, which means that they are, can somehow act as a real-time map, right? And that's probably also one of the negative sides of printed maps, because you have to imagine, let's say you have like a, whatever, like a big map, like a huge map printed of Berlin. In the moment when you print it, it's actually already outdated, right? Because the landscape, the area around us is changing, it's dynamic like a river. And in that moment when you print or when you create something like this, then you cannot, you can actually never say that this map is the current state. So it means that maps can be helpful for us, but can be for a short period of time, but can also limit the use of these maps, especially when they are printed. And I think that the main goal of Google Maps is to overcome this state and to say like, okay, here, look, right now we are creating a tool that doesn't come with this kind of outdated situation anymore. It's kind of a representing of the world around us, a real-time representing of the world around us. So unfortunately, as technology likes us, or sometimes it doesn't like us, the codec didn't work for the presentation. So here I would like to show you the Google Maps hacks, maybe also for the one. Who doesn't know it? So yes. In the beginning of this year, in February, there was the 15th birthday of Google Maps. And 1 week before the birthday, I was I published this project on Twitter. And what the project is about, so what you see is there's a guy walking the street of Berlin with a red wagon, and in this wagon there are 99 smartphones. On the smartphones, there are all of them, there are Android smartphones. And what's happening is that when you're walking alongside the street, forward, backward, and sometimes also a bit faster, sometimes a bit slower, then it generates some virtual traffic on Google Maps, and this had the effect. In the moment that people which are using Google Maps navigation system are being linked around me or about this guy, and after a while you could literally feel it that suddenly the street was getting empty and empty of cars. And this was quite interesting to see, like how such a huge impact these navigation systems and especially the maps has on our way how we use them, but also in a way like how people are traveling and navigating in the city. And this kind of, you know, slow, faster movement, as I mentioned, it was also some kind of a trick to think about like how could the algorithm read 99 cars in a way as a traffic jam. So with this action, we were trying to also generate some kind of stop-and-go traffic. And I would say the hack, or let's say the performance itself, I got the idea at the 1st of May demonstration in Berlin, where I saw a lot of people working alongside the street, especially in Kreuzberg. And in that time, I had a look at my smartphone, and I realized that Google was showing a lot of like a huge virtual traffic at around Cottbusser Tor. but in fact there was no car driving at all in the city or in this place there. So and it was quite clear to me that they are tracking those smartphones of the people and then they are creating the virtual traffic out of it. And I was asking myself, okay, how can I create something similar to this? And then of course, I mean, it was clear that I just need smartphones and not the people for this, to do a similar effect. And yeah, I mean, then the journey began, like how to get the smartphones and so on. And but this was quite hard in a way at the beginning because I thought, okay, like, is there, you know, there must be some kind of secondhand smartphones in, let's say, companies at airports and so on, because all the employees, they're getting smartphones like every 3 years, 4 years. But unfortunately, I didn't get any, let's say, response from them to say, like, yeah, of course, you can use it here for something like this. And then I came up with the idea, okay, maybe out of, let's say, if I want to generate something like this, I could also make another performance out of it to ask, let's say, friends if they are willing to give me their smartphone for 1 day and if they basically can live without their smartphone for 1 day and I'm going to use their smartphones for this hack. And this was actually interesting to me that most people were first of all like, yeah, okay, I can, let's see how it works. And but then after a while they said like, okay, I'm gonna give you the smartphone and then we can let's do it, and then we will see if I can survive the smartphone for 1 day. Of course I don't have 99 friends, so I also got smartphones from some official smartphone suppliers. And yeah, and then basically I had all the smartphones for 1 day, did the performance, and it was after 1 hour working inside the screen, it was in a way quite obvious that this kind of performance or this kind of hack will work. Let me quickly jump out of the presentation because I would like to give you also another let's say future point of view. Oh yeah, there's a So maybe as an let's say future point of view in that sense, like how I could imagine, or also as can be also already seen, like how Google is let's say trying to optimize and trying to work on their tools in a new way. I think the keyword here is the so-called personalized routes. So there is this application Pokemon Go. And in this application, people, let's say users of this application, they are getting routed to, let's say, hidden areas, hidden places, and also to some places where they can find some raw Pokemons. In the application itself, it's so-called a Pokestop. And what's going on here is that there are some pretty, let's say, weird corporations between let's say companies with some kind of marketing ideas or motivations behind it. So in Japan, what's going on there is that McDonald's and Pokemon Go, they are cooperating through the map of Google, and they're telling Google, okay, McDonald's is telling Pokemon Go, could you please place some raw Pokemons in front of our stores so that a lot of people are getting together there, and maybe they're gonna come up with some ideas to, you know, go into the store and get some food. So here I definitely see a kind of an interesting and well, somehow also a playfulness way, like how people are being driven by these tools through the map of through the Google Maps. And I could highly imagine that this kind of stuff could be also happening, that, you know, when I go from A to B, another person goes from the same A to the same B, that we are getting different routes with regards to our profile and, let's say, you know, what we are like, and then basically we are gonna be navigated close by shops where we're gonna think maybe that might work, the Google algorithm thinks maybe that might be interesting for that person. So yeah, and then maybe as a last because I guess then we have 1 minute left as the last few words. I mean, I would say that as a conclusion, it's quite obvious, of course, that we're gonna have to trust these maps. We have to trust this kind of, let's say, transformation system where a lot of informations are being gathered together, and they're gonna come up through those maps as a kind of visualized, let's say, tool in a way. But for me, it was interesting to see like how we trust on the one hand this tool, but on the other hand, it was creepy to see how easy it is to hack this tool, and how easy it is also to, let's say, manipulate data, and how we are then being shaped by this data when we are working in a city. And I think this gives, I would say that, let's say, art performance like Google Maps should somehow, let's say, open our eyes to how we think, let's say, objective technology is. And I think it should somehow also raise the question like that we should not always trust these data. We should always kind of questioning this kind of technology in a sense, when fighting for an availability as well, like that it's going to be transparent, and that we always get a, let's say, I don't know, idea of where this data comes from. Yeah, and I would say that's pretty much it for the.
Yeah, thank you very much. That was super interesting. I think actually there could be a future similar workshop to how we're working today on seeing how YouTube shows different things in the future, how YouTube or how Google Maps shows you different routes. That's quite a scary development. Yeah, I would like to just ask you one question before we open up to the audience. And I'm sure you get this question quite a lot, but do you know if anything was changed by Google in their algorithm or their software after you did this performance, or was there any change, or are we still able to do this hack?
I mean, it's definitely possible. There are already some let's say copycats out there. So there are YouTube videos where people are generating a similar virtual traffic. I mean, the thing is that Google spokesperson said like, yeah, they are, you know, no matter what's in the city, if it's like a whatever car, camel, or a person on a camel, or something else, they are trying to track everything. And there was another sentence that they are also happy about, that, you know, people make aware of such kind of bugs, and they are trying to filter these kind of events out. So for sure I will test the system, I don't know, maybe a half year or a year, and then figure out if it still works or not. But I have the feeling it's going to be quite hard for them to filter something like this.
Yeah, I guess something will always be possible to hack it. Yeah. Great. So are there any questions from our audience? We still have a bit of time before we start with the workshop.
Yeah, last.
So just a technical question about the act you have done on Google Maps. The 99 cell phone should be on Google, like, or just with GPS activated, or
you have to activate. I mean, of course, right, there are three different ways how smartphones can be tracked. So I would say the most accurate is GPS. Then you have, let's say, the network location system, which works over antennas in the city. It's like a triangulation calculation, and then you have Wi-Fi. And I enabled all three of them. And then the thing is also important to mention is that I didn't have to open Google Maps on the smartphone. It was literally just Android. I mean, probably it works better when you have Google Maps running as an application on the smartphone. But for sure, they are also tracking you when you don't have it running Google Maps.
I think there was another question here in the front.
Thanks for the talk. That was really interesting. And I've got a question. You were mentioning copycats or copy kids.
Yeah.
Anything interesting you've seen there coming up on YouTube? People, you know, elaborating on your idea and maybe, you know, giving you a new angle on what you started there?
I mean, of course, there had been some people mentioned, like, I mean, I got a lot of, let me think, I got some kind of ideas where people thought, okay, it could be interesting to use it also in another way. I mean, not from the guys from YouTube, they are literally were trying to, you know, to simulate that. But of course, right, I mean, you have to imagine like this, I mean, the Google algorithm is also learning, let's say that when there's a traffic going on every week on the same time, then after a while it will also predict that in a way. And then I think people came up with the idea, okay, you know, when I gonna do that, let's say 3-4 times, then will it be possible for the next time the street will be empty, and then I have basically, you know, when I cycle from A to B, then the street will be when I go to work, for example, and the street will be empty. This kind of ideas came up during the conversation, or let's say in the comments. Might be interesting to see. I mean, also, by the way, that's, I think, also important to mention. I mean, as an artist, I always try to, or that's my understanding, I really try to come up with some easy, let's say, narratives to, for wider audience to understand, like, how this technology works, right? And this was, for me, to use the smartphones, a pretty, let's say, understandable, easy-to-read way. But I also have to mention that there are multiple ways to simulate something like this. I mean, buzzwords are, you know, GPS spoofing, as we know it from Pokemon Go as well, like how they are using it. And but of course, you can also use, let's say, trick the Google API. There are already some papers out there where people did it like 5 years ago. But I would say for an audience which is not so familiar with technology, let's say hard to read that or to understand that, and then I think that's probably also the reason why the 99 smartphones got a lot of attention, because it was easier to read.
Do we have one more question here?
Yes, I wanted to ask you, if you thought the way this kind of hack could also be used in political activist terms, so for sure could be interesting when you want to have a street empty out of the traffic, but there is also a reflection from you of how it could be used tactically to have this emptiness in the street, something that also is related to the control of the people of their data and not just being controlled by data.
Well, I mean, first of all, I guess I see it as a statement because I think you're right. I mean, that's probably true. It can be, of course, it's highly imaginable, like how this, let's say, a hack can be also used in a totally different way, right? How it can be, I mean, or maybe to give you another example, I also, well, there's another interesting side effect in it when you think about the protesting culture in a city. So I would say that when people are going out in the street to protest, I think one of their, let's say, aims is also to interrupt the everyday life. So you want to make people aware of something. You want to, basically interrupt their way to their work or, you know. So it means that when there's a protest and, you know, you have to wait for, and then you're going to spend the time with their topics, and then you're going to think about it and so on. Especially when you're sitting, let's say, in a car. But what's happening with Google Maps is that once there is, let's say, this kind of traffic jam and a lot of protesters walking alongside the streets, then basically Google will avoid that you're gonna be stuck in the traffic, or let's say in the protesters there. So it will basically link you around the protesters. That means that you sitting in a car will never understand what was going on there, or why you have been rerouted around this traffic, and you actually also don't understand was there traffic or was there actually a protest or demonstration going on. So I think the effect of intervention of the protests is somehow in that sense gone, because we're getting the softer route around it, and then therefore we will not know what was actually going on there.
Then we have one more question at the back, or even two.
Hi, thank you for the presentation. I was wondering if in order for the hack to work, you had to walk on the street, like on the road necessarily, or if Google has any idea, Google Maps, whether of the differentiation between a sidewalk and the road.
I mean, we worked on the street. I'm not sure what would happen when we worked on the street side, because yeah, I mean, we tried to simulate cars basically, and then we thought, okay, we have to walk on the street. I don't know. Might be another test to do. Yeah.
Okay, then I think we have one question at the back. Please try to keep it a bit short because we don't have too much time left.
Okay, so I have something anecdotal and maybe a project for people to think about. On October 11th, there's a memorial for David Graeber, a very well-known anarchist anthropologist who passed away. And it sort of upset me that this worldwide memorial, very beautiful idea to do a carnival memorial on October 11th, is being organized on Google Maps. And it concerns me that in these times where, let's say, like Antifa is, you know, possibly under siege in very dangerous ways in the US and other places, to make a map for Google of all these people who would be participating in David Graeber's memorial is not really such a great idea. And if just wondering if there's some ideas that might be out there that we could create something that would be another way of organizing some of this. I realize this map is already in motion and being created, but for other people who are more concerned about their security, if people have ideas about how to create a parallel map that doesn't have Google's tentacles in it, would be great. Mm.
Well, good question. I mean, so far I don't know it, but I mean, I totally also get that point. I mean, for example, you have to imagine that these maps have also been used during the Hong Kong and still, right, during the Hong Kong protests, and they can be used perfectly as a tracking tool to record and to monitor where a lot of people are working in the city, and then to organize the police in a way. So, well, I mean, I would say in that sense, first of all, yeah, put your smartphone into flight mode if you don't want to be, let's say, being tracked, right? Especially when you're protesting, and yeah. But unfortunately, right now, I have nothing. I have no idea about that now.
All right. So thank you very much. We're out of time, but it was a really great start of the day. So thanks again to you. Thank you.